what we're going to be doing with these short stories, the short stories that you looked at for today, and the short stories that you looked at, that you will be looking at in the coming weeks, right? What we're looking for in each of these texts is some sense of what literary theorists call an implied author. Now, the implied author is not necessarily the same as the literal author of the work, right? What the implied author is not a literal person who writes a story. The implied author is a set of values and contexts implied by the story. Right, so to give you an example of what I mean, right? Now, we all grow up in a particular social world, a particular social context, right? Now, one thing that I, you know, noticed when I first moved down here is that the social context I grew up in is very different from the one that I find myself in now, right? I'm from Northeast Pennsylvania. Any of you ever watch The Office? Okay, one or two of you? Yeah, okay. Scranton, where that takes place, that is more or less where I'm from. So, Northeast Pennsylvania is primarily Irish and Polish. Right, it's an old coal mining region. Had an industrial economy, now has basically no economy. And used to be, until quite recently, like when I was growing up there, most voters were Democrats, a lot of union members. Predominantly Roman Catholic. Now this looks quite different in a lot of ways from Southwest Georgia, right? Different ethnic mix, different religious values, different political values, different economy, right? What's the economic base in Southwest Georgia? What kind of economy is it primarily? Exactly, yeah, agricultural, farming. What's the ethnic mix like down here?
Mix of both, primarily black and white.
Yeah, okay, there's a large African-American population. Most white people are of English, Scots-Irish, or French descent. At least that's what I gather, judging by people's last names and what I know about regional history, right? So not Irish and Polish coal miners. What about in terms of religion?
Protestant.
Yeah, primarily various kinds of Protestant, right? A lot of Baptists, a lot of Methodists. So, when I came down here, right, like it was difficult for me to read a lot of situations clearly because I wasn't used to being in this kind of context, right? For example, in addition to the fact that people where I come from are mostly Catholic, people also tend to be much more private about their religious beliefs, right? Church is a much less central part of people's social lives. You know, it's not that people are necessarily less religious, but people don't talk about it nearly as much. And, you know, you could know someone for years, you could work with somebody for years, be friends with somebody for years, and never really know or care what church they go to. Now, when I first moved down here, what do you think was about the first question people I met asked me? Yeah, have you found a church home yet? Which to me seemed weird and invasive, right? Because where I come from, you don't ask people that. It wasn't meant to be invasive or nosy, right? It was, I think, in most cases meant to be welcoming. But because I didn't understand my new social context yet, right? I didn't interpret it that way. and so I clammed up and got a little hostile. Gun culture is also very different where I come from, right? People have guns. People like having guns. But most of the people who have guns did have guns solely to hunt and usually keep them locked up in a safe if they're not out hunting. People having guns, you know, people having guns in their cars, things like that. That was something I was not used to. Even certain phrases, you know, when somebody, you know, first came up to me and said, "Oh, I appreciate you." I was like, "Oh, that's nice. That's sweet. I appreciate you too." And I didn't realize it was just thanks, you know? So what I'm trying to get at here is that the stories that we're reading are often going to have been written in contexts that you're not familiar with and that you're not used to. And so when we're looking for the implied author in a text, in a lot of ways what we're looking for is this set of values and this set of contexts in which the text was composed. Right? We're trying to read the text sympathetically, right? We're trying to read with the author instead of imposing our own views and values on the text, right? There's a text I used to teach in this class a lot. I haven't taught it in a little while. It's called A Good Man is Hard to Find by Flannery O'Connor. Any of you familiar with it? Any of you read it in high school? I will take your generalized silence to mean no. Okay. That's fine. Essentially, the story is about a grandmother who goes on vacation with her son's family. It's where the grandmother lives with the family. And the grandmother is, you know, they live in Atlanta. And the grandmother is, in a lot of ways, pretty horrible. She's selfish. She's casually racist. And she's very, very nostalgic, sort of for the plantation days. And the children are very disrespectful towards the grandmother. And I used to get a lot of response papers on that text in which, you know, students would say, well, the children need to be more respectful of their grandmother because she's their grandmother. And they were kind of missing those cues that the story doesn't want us to respect the grandmother, right? The story wants us to think, you know, keeps presenting the grandmother to us as an awful person who really only cares about herself. But the students who were reading the story were also reading their own cultural values onto the story, right? You're supposed to respect your elders. So maybe the children went a little over the top in disrespecting the grandmother in the story, but the story itself, if you're sympathizing with the grandmother in the story, you're not actually reading the story sympathetically. Do you see what I'm getting at? Okay. So anytime you find yourself reading a text and thinking that a character should or ought to behave a certain way, then you're probably falling into this trap, right? You're probably not reading the text sympathetically. Remember that characters and stories are not real people. They have never been real people. Any resemblance they may bear to real persons, living or dead, is purely coincidental. Right, what characters and stories really are is just a set of words on a page. And those words build up an idea of a person, right? But every time whenever you read the story, like if you go back and, you know, how many of you have read the Harry Potter novels? I can imagine several of you probably, yes, okay, or at least seen the movies. Okay. If you go and reread the book or watch the movie again, are the characters gonna do different things? Yeah, the actions they take will never change. The words they say will never change. You can't fix what's wrong in a character's behavior. All you can do is try to analyze it from a sympathetic perspective. So that's what we're doing in trying to look for these implied authors. So let's try a little bit of this with that Arthur Machen story. I try to be so careful about this that I end up being too careful. And by stepping too gingerly, I ruin everything. Okay. Right. Stay. I mean it, don't move. Okay, so there were two of you who weren't here last time, right?
Okay, so let me just give this to you. So you have a copy. So let's start by thinking about the context of this, right? Did any of you look on the little endnotes page and check out sort of like when this was written? Okay, so what era does this come from? Yes? Oh, you didn't get one. All right, you weren't here either. You didn't get one. Okay.
And you are?
You're
John.
Okay.
All right, so when was this written? What major historical events is in the background of this story?
World War II?
It's World War I, yes. First World War.
Good.
And what phase of the war, early or late, if we look at the date? First published in the London Evening News, October 20th, 1914. So this is fairly early in the First World War, right? Before things really started to go pear-shaped. And, you know, before a significant portion of the young male population of Europe had been killed in the trenches. So this is before things had got really awful. Now, as we're establishing context here, what else did I tell you last time? Do you remember anything else that I told you about this writer and his usual style or his usual subject matter last time?
He writes great things.
Yeah, he is a writer of what's sometimes called weird fiction, or you know, weird tales, right? Supernatural stories. So, you know, a lot of his works involve ghosts, monsters, you know, elder gods from beyond the stars with lots of tentacles and, you know, things of that nature. So this guy is a writer of supernatural stories, so that is another context here to keep in mind, right? Not everything he writes is in that vein, but if we know that this is his usual style, it gives us some sense of what to expect. Now, I gave you another couple of brief definitions at the end of class last time. I asked you to think about this in terms of whether it was a story of incident or a story of character. Does anybody remember what these terms mean? What's a story of incident?
I just
yes, good. Thank you, Alexander. Yes, a story of incident is primarily concerned with an event. Right? What happens is more important in the story than, say, who it happens to, right? What about a story of character? What's a story of character?
Character stuck up.
Yeah, very good. Thank you, Guy Briani. Yes, a story of character is more concerned with revealing the personality or psychology of a character. This doesn't mean that nothing happens in a story of character, or that, you know, stories of events don't have any character developments. It's really just about emphasis, right? A story of incident is going to emphasize the thing that happens, and the story of character is going to emphasize a character's personality. So, what do you think the soldier's rest is? Which category would you say this belongs to if you had to put it into one or the other, and why?
I would say a story of character, because the whole time it's kind of analyzing his thought process despite his, you know, situation he's in and how happy he is and stuff.
Okay, so you would say that it's more about revealing this particular character's personality, this the wounded soldier. Okay, how many of you agree with Aaron that that's the story's primary concern? That it's more about the wounded soldier's personality and the development of his personality?
I think it's about story based then because it keeps getting flashbacks about like what happened to him, like to it keeps going back and it's explaining like why he has the wound on his head. So basically it takes you through the events of the process to, you know, where he got the wound.
Okay.
To his head.
Where he got the wound and how he got to be in this place. Right. And here's the thing, like, neither of you are wrong, right? This is one of the things that is both exhilarating and frustrating about English classes, right? Is that by and large, there aren't right or wrong answers. Some answers are better than others, but really the strength of the answers you come up with is more about the case you can make for your position based on evidence, right? So, how many of you agree with Shaking that this is a story of incident, that what matters here more is the event? Okay, at least two of you, all right. So, let's actually sort of focus first on what we can tell about this character's personality. What is this guy like? What can we tell about him? What can we tell, for example, about his nationality? Yeah, he's British.
Good.
What social class do you think he belongs to? Do you think this is, you know, a high-up officer guy, somebody from a wealthy background, or somebody from, like, a more working class? Okay. What suggests to you that he's working class? Okay, what about the way he talks about the child? Can you give me an example?
He was excited when he gave him a toy.
Okay, well, you know, I mean,
yeah.
Rich people theoretically do nice things for children now and again too, right?
Yeah,
Emily.
Is that like he's learning the words from the child, the way he says the words, but he's not.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, he's associating with simple farm folk. There's a much, much simpler means we can use, though, to figure out what this guy's social class is, though. And it has to do with language as well. How does he talk?
Broken English.
Yeah, or what he talks in, like, dialect, right? He doesn't talk in a kind of, you know, sort of snooty standard English, right? So the fact that he talks in dialect indicates to us that he's working class. What else is revealed here just about this guy's personality? What kind of guy is he?
He seems kind of positive, pretty happy.
Okay.
At the beginning, at least.
What makes him seem positive to you, Aaron?
Just like reading the first, second, and third paragraphs, it talks about his mood and stuff like that, how, you know, despite his giant head wound and stuff, he's just talking with the people that he's around, maybe the nurse or something, and he's just what surrounds him kind of puts him in a better mood, he's setting him in.
Could also be woozy from the giant head wound. You know, maybe that makes you interpret your surroundings a little differently. But yeah, okay, so he seems reasonable. But how does he seem to feel about his country and his cause and his comrades?
Well,
How does he seem to feel about his country and his comrades in the army?
Sacrifice himself to try to save them, so he definitely cares about the fellow soldiers.
Yeah. He's self-sacrificing. The story also shows some definite hints of pretty predictable national prejudices in this particular period, right? The British and the French are nice. The Germans are barbaric. So we got, you know, this guy, you know, shows himself to be fairly patriotic. And he also shows him sort of, as we said, to be sort of sensitive to children, right? Now let's shift our focus for a moment to kind of the central events in the story, right? Because I think this is about as far as we're going to get with the character in a story this short. And it's only about 4 or 5 pages. What's the central thing that this guy is trying to figure out? What's the big thing that's happened in this story? Yeah, he's trying to figure out where the hell he is and how he got there, right? 1 minute, he's fighting in a battle in this little border town in France. The next, he wakes up, you know, he gets a giant head wound. The next minute, he wakes up here. And does the place he's in look anything like the place he had been in?
No.
What does the place he's in look like? If we look on the first page here, the wounded soldier was somewhat of this disposition as he opened his eyes, pulled himself together, and looked about him. He felt a sense of delicious ease and repose in bones that had been racked and weary, and deep in the heart that had so lately been tormented, there was an assurance of comfort. Of the battle won. The thundering, roaring waves were past. He had entered into the haven of calm waters. After fatigues and terrors that as yet he could not recollect, he seemed now to be resting in the easiest of all easy chairs in a dim, low room. In the hearth there was a glint of fire and a blue, sweet-scented puff of wood smoke. A great black oak beam, roughly hewn, crossed the ceiling. Through the leaded panes of the windows, he saw a rich glow of sunlight, green lawns, and against the deepest and most radiant of all blue skies, the wonderful far-lifted towers of a vast Gothic cathedral, mystic, rich with imagery. "Good Lord," he murmured to himself, "I didn't know they had such places in France. It's just like Wells. And it might be the other day when I was going past the Swan, just as it might be past that window, and asked the ostler what time it was. And he says, 'What time? Why, summertime. And there outside it looks like summer that would last forever. If this was an inn, they ought to call it the Soldier's Rest.'" So the place he's in, what does it seem to remind him of?
His home.
Yeah. It looks like home. And his home is a sort of remote little town in rural England, right, that has these kinds of country inns with rough-hewn oak beams in the ceilings and leaded panes in the windows. Right, the kind of town that has, you know, an old Gothic cathedral in it. So he looks around him and like, this doesn't look like France anymore, right? This looks like he's back in England. And is he alone here? Who else is here with him? Yeah, a guy who he refers to as a minister, right, because he wears black robes. So there's a man in black robes. Who shows up and starts talking to him. Where do you think the soldier is? What do you think this place is?
Heaven.
Why do you think it's heaven, Gabriana? What suggests to you heaven?
Because end when they were praising him.
Okay.
When everybody was praising him, and it.
Okay, a bunch of other guys in black robes show up, right?
Credit to the British Army.
Mm-hmm. By God, sir, he said, you're a credit to the British Army. You're a damn fine soldier and a good man, and by God, I'm proud to shake hands with you. And then someone came out of the shadow, someone in queer clothes such as the soldier had seen worn by the heralds when he had been on duty at the opening of Parliament by the king. Now, by Corpus Domini, this man said, of all knights ye be the noblest and gentlest, and ye be of fairest report. And now ye be a brother of the noblest brotherhood that ever was since this world's beginning, since ye have yielded dear life for your friend's sake. So, these guys are all costumed differently, right? They're dressed in the clothes of different eras. And they use the language of different eras as well, right? There's one guy who talks like a British officer of the late 19th, early 20th centuries, right? You're a damn fine soldier, and you know, all that. And there's another guy who speaks in these and thous and yees and wherefores, right? There are other people who come up to him and are speaking French. So yeah, he's in this place that looks like his hometown inn in Britain. These guys keep coming up and telling him what a damn fine soldier he was and welcome to the Brotherhood. What's happening to him? What has he done that's brought him here?
Sacrifice his life, right?
Yeah, he's dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. That should be pretty clear to all of us by now, right? That he is not in any earthly place. He's dead, and he's back in this kind of ideal country, Britain, with these historical figures coming up and congratulating him. Some of them speak French. Now, a little side note here, anybody know why there would be people walking around speaking French in a brotherhood of dead British warriors? Does anybody have any idea what happened in England in 1066 that changed the way we speak? Pardon? Magna Carta is a little later. Magna Carta is 13th century. Okay, in 1066, at the Battle of Hastings, a native English army was defeated by an army of people called the Normans from northern France, right? From the Normandy region of northern France. So for the next several centuries, England is actually ruled by French speakers. So the guy who leads this this invasion, was William, Duke William the Bastard of Normandy, and once he conquers England, he gets to start calling himself William the Conqueror, which is much, much better than being William the Bastard. And it also means that the English aristocracy, which would mean most of knighthood, right? Most of the medieval knights we imagine, you know, riding around England in armor and knocking each other off horses and impaling each other in brutal tournaments and things of that nature, would have been French speakers. And a lot of the sort of the King Arthur stories that maybe, you know, you knew when you were a kid were originally circulated in various dialects of French. If you look at contemporary English, a lot of our legal terms, a lot of our military terms, our fashion words, our cooking words tend to come from French, right? The sorts of areas of life that mattered most to medieval aristocrats. So I'm going to give you two lists of words here, and you tell me how they're related to each other, right? Chicken, poultry, bull, beef, sheep,
Mutton. What are the words in this column? They're animals, right? What about the words in the other column?
Food type.
Yeah, the food that comes from that animal, right? The animal names all come from Old English, Anglo-Saxon. The food names all come from French. Because an English peasant would raise the animal for the table of his French lord. So that's just a little side note there, a little linguistic history that, you know, do with that what you will. So there are French speakers hanging about in this British inn as well, and this is why. What about this cup they give him to drink from? Right, the soldier did not understand what the man was saying to him. There were others, too, in strange dresses who came and spoke to him. Some spoke in what sounded like French. He could not make it out, but he knew that they all spoke kindly and praised him. What does it all mean, he said to the minister. What are they talking about? They don't think I'd let down my pals. Drink this, said the minister, and he handed the soldier a great silver cup brimming with wine. The soldier took a deep draught, and in that moment all his sorrows passed from him. What is it, he asked. Vin nouveau du royaume, right? New wine of the kingdom, you call it. And then he bent down and murmured in the soldier's ear. What's going on with the silver cup? What does the silver cup make you think of? Full of new wine of the kingdom. Okay, yeah, that's one possible resonance here, right? You know, this looks like the cup of a carpenter and all that. Right, the cup of the Last Supper, right, that all of King Arthur's knights go questing after, right? And there certainly seems to be that association of the contemporary British soldier with the medieval knight. And what else might it represent that's sort of related to that Holy Grail ideal, but is maybe a little bit simpler?
What, silver mean like noble tea or something?
Maybe? He's being inducted into a noble brotherhood, right? Certainly, now he's now on an equal level with people who would be of a much higher social class than he was. I mean, what happens, say, in Catholic churches every Sunday, or in some Protestant churches once a month? Yeah, communion, right? This is a kind of communion ceremony. Right, he drinks the, you know, you eat the bread, you drink the wine, and, you know, depending on which religious tradition you come from, you might believe it's the literal body and blood of Christ. You might believe it's symbolic, right? Most Catholic, you know, Catholic, in Catholicism, it's supposed to be the literal body and blood. In most Protestant traditions, it's supposed to be purely symbolic, right? So you dip your little hunk of wheat bread into grape juice. But the whole point of the ceremony really is a kind of communal meal, right? You're all individuals who came to this place before the communion, and then once the communion is over, then you're part of a community, right? You're a member of the group. So this is largely inclusion in a group. So let's try and apply all of this then to those contexts that we talked about a little earlier, right? The fact that this is written in the early stages of the First World War, and that the author is a writer of supernatural fiction, right? The fact that he's a writer of supernatural fiction means that, you know, putting this guy in, you know, sort of heaven or limbo or purgatory, whatever it is, and surrounding him with ghostly knights, okay, that's par for the course, right? We expect that sort of thing from somebody who writes this kind of story. What does the early First World War context tell us about its concerns?
Well,
How are we supposed to feel at the end of the story about the war and the soldiers who are fighting in it? Is this story's attitude towards the war in any way complicated? You're shaking your head no, Bailey. You don't think so? Why not? Yeah. This is, you know, heroic sacrifice for one's country and one's allies, right? Yeah, so the heroic sacrifice is supposed to be read as a good thing. Right. This was not a waste of a soldier's life. He's part of the Brotherhood of Heroes now. And what about the way the story characterizes the enemy, the German? What's the only thing we see Germans doing in this story?
Being brutal.
Yeah. Basically knifing a child in the throat, right? So really over the top brutality. So yeah, it's really a pretty simple attitude towards the war. The war is a good and necessary thing, and such sacrifices in war are good and necessary things. In a way, like, it reads almost like a propaganda piece, right? There's no complicated attitude towards the war. The soldier did everything right. There's no one to blame for his death, right? His death was a glorious thing. Now, if we think about this too, it's coming from the early stages of the war, right? This is before most villages in Britain had coffins coming home every day. So it was much easier to maintain a positive attitude about the war, right? It wasn't coming as close to home yet. And if we look as well at Britain's position in Europe compared to, say, where the French position was. Now, how many of you know anything about the histories of World War I and World War II? A little bit, Aaron? Okay. Was Britain actually physically threatened or invaded in World War I?
No.
Britain is, you know, being on an island safely buffered by France and Belgium, right? Now, in World War II, it was a different story. Right, there were German planes bombing English cities every day. But Machen is writing from a relatively secure place. And indeed, the place he brings his hero back to is a secure place. Okay, so let's try some of this with the Raymond Carver story as well. Now, the Carver story, I think, is a little bit more complicated because we have, in some ways, a narrator who we're not inclined to be sympathetic towards, right? What can we tell about the narrator in Cathedral? What do we know about him? What can we infer about him? Pardon?
He doesn't
like the blind man, at least not initially, right?
He seemed fairly stereotypical and kind of grouchy. Even towards his wife.
Okay.
Seems really jealous.
Why would you say jealous, Shaking?
Because he always talks about, like, how... just the words that he used when he was describing, like, their conversations between the blind man and his wife.
Uh-huh.
And then even previously with the old officer that she married.
Mm-hmm.
It just seemed like to be kind of on the jealous side of what she was doing.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit about the way he discusses her ex-husband. Like, let's look a little bit more closely at some of those passages. Right, page 35, right, that summer in Seattle, she had needed a job. She didn't have any money. The man she was going to marry at the end of the summer was an officer's training school. He didn't have any money either, but she was in love with the guy and he was in love with her, etc. Right. When we put et cetera at the end of a sentence, which, by the way, don't do that in your papers. When you put et cetera at the end of a sentence, essentially, what are you doing?
Don't feel like talking about the rest.
Yes. Exactly. It's evasion, right? This is something you feel it's either unnecessary to discuss or that you simply don't want to discuss. Right. Anyway, this man who'd first enjoyed her favors, the officer-to-be, he'd been her childhood sweetheart. So, okay, I'm saying at the end of the summer, she let the blind man run his hands over her face, said goodbye to him, married her childhood etc., who was now a commissioned officer, and she moved away from Seattle. But they'd kept in touch, she and the blind man. And he goes on to talk about the tapes and whatnot, right? Does he ever refer to his wife's ex-husband as her husband? It's always the officer, right? Her officer, or something mocking like the man who had first enjoyed her favors, right? He is unable to name this guy to whom his wife used to be married. So that's an indication that that relationship makes him uncomfortable, right? The fact that his wife was married to someone else before him. And what is it that makes him uncomfortable about the blind man? What are the first things he tells us about the blind man?
Brought him over his hands on his wife's face.
Yeah. He remembers her telling him about this, the blind man touching her face. Right. On her last day in the office, the blind man asked if he could touch her face. She agreed to this. She told me he touched his fingers to every part of her face, her nose, even her neck. She never forgot it. And then he's very dismissive about the poem that she wrote about it, right? Eh, she writes these bullshit poems once a year, and I don't care about poetry. Why would he be so upset that this blind man has touched her face? What would be the actual reason the blind man is touching her face?
To see what she looks like.
Yeah, to try to see what she looks like. You know, that's, you know, if you don't have a sense of sight, you use your other senses to try to fill in the gaps, right? So, you know, a blind person often will ask to touch your face in order to get a sense of what you look like. But touching someone's face is still a really intimate gesture, right? Running your fingers over someone else's facial features. The way the guy describes it is kind of sensual, right? He seems to be imagining it as almost a kind of, you know, violation or sexual contact, right? What else might indicate to us that this guy is extremely jealous?
He always refers to the blind man as the blind man.
Mm-hmm.
Does he know his name?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he knows the guy's name. And he does make a shift in, like, the last third of the story, right? Once they establish a connection with each other, then he starts calling the guy Robert and stops calling him the blind man. But the blind man remains just this kind of abstraction through the early parts of the story. Right? He's not Robert, he's just the blind man. So he starts out doing the same thing to Robert that he was doing with the officer, right? Any part of his wife's life that came before him makes him upset, makes him jealous. Now, once Robert is in the house, are there indications here that he's still jealous? That, you know, is there any indication here of things that might tell us what his real problem is?
So he's still jealous about the way he talks to him.
Okay, is he actually rude to Robert once Robert's there?
He's kind of trying.
He's kind of throwing shade at him because he's saying, like, when I said earlier about him being kind of stereotypical. He was like, not only blind, or all blind people wear glasses. And he was saying like he was surprised that he had a full beard. And that he was capable of doing a lot of things that he didn't think blind people could even do.
Yeah. Robert doesn't have the visual trappings of a blind person that this guy expects, right? What does this guy expect a blind person is supposed to look like?
Dog shades and a stick.
Yep, exactly. You're supposed to have dog shades and a cane. And that Robert doesn't have any of those things. You know, get the poor man a dog. His wife just died. Everyone needs a dog. But yeah, so Robert doesn't look like a blind person is supposed to look. This actually tells us another important thing about the narrator and where the narrator gets most of his information, gets his cues, right? That Robert doesn't look right for a blind person. But we'll put that to the side for a minute. When Robert and the wife are talking, how does the narrator behave? Yeah, he's sitting, waiting, listening for him, for his name to come up, waiting for her to say something about him, and she never does. Look on page 40. First paragraph. We took ourselves into the living room and sank into our places again. Robert and my wife sat on the sofa. I took the big chair, so he physically sets himself apart from the other two. They sit together on the sofa, he sits somewhere else. We had us two or three more drinks while they talked about the major things that had come to pass for them in the past 10 years. Did anybody know, like, they drink a staggering amount of alcohol in this story, right? I mean, how are they standing? For the most part, I just listened. Now and then I joined in. I didn't want him to think I'd left the room, and I didn't want her to think I was feeling left out. They talked of things that had happened to them, these past 10 years. I waited in vain to hear my name on my wife's sweet lips, and then my dear husband came into my life, something like that. But I heard nothing of the sort. More talk of Robert. So he wants his wife to say something about him. Does he ever say to anyone how he's feeling? He keeps all of this to himself, right? He doesn't tell his wife he's feeling left out. He doesn't tell his wife, hey, I wish you would, you know, include me in the conversation. He just sits there and quietly hopes that she'll bring him up or that she'll include him. So what does this indicate to us about the reason this guy is so jealous? What's the what would seem to be at the root of it? What sort of personality trait would be at the root of his jealousy? If you're just sitting there, you know, you're at a party, you're with a couple of people, and you know them, right? And they're just, you know, having a conversation, you're kind of on the edge of it, and you're just sitting there like, oh, please, please, please mention me, right? Please talk, like, what kind of personality would we say that you have?
Is he self-centered, or?
Maybe self-centered. He certainly doesn't seem to have very many social connections, right? He doesn't seem to be close to anyone else.
She says he doesn't have friends.
Yeah, he doesn't have any friends. She said, I love it if you would have, if you had friends, please bring them over. That'd be great, but you don't.
Can you call that antisocial?
But he wants to be included, right?
So he wants to be liked.
Yeah, he wants to be liked. He's not being, he's not being distant because he hates other people and hates social contact, right? It's almost like he doesn't know how. It's almost like he doesn't know how to make a connection with other people, right? A lot of this seems to suggest like a high level of insecurity. It's like he really doesn't want to know what his wife and Robert have said about him on the tape. Right? They pass these cassette tapes back and forth. Do you guys even know what a cassette tape is? I haven't even seen one. Okay, good. All right. That's comforting, mildly. They mail these tapes to each other back and forth, you know, in lieu of writing letters. And there's a tape and his name is on it, and it gets interrupted and they never go back to it, right? This is probably not accidental. He's both desperate to know and really doesn't want to know what they have to say about him. And really, of the three characters in the story, who's the one about whom we know the least?
Him, the narrator.
Yeah. We know less about him, we know less about the details of his life than we do about either of the other two, right? He gives us his wife's whole history. He gives us much of Robert's history, even, you know, the speculative history of Robert's marriage. But what things does he actually tell us about himself?
He drank a lot of his old weed.
Yeah, but these are things we see from his actions, right? And we learn he doesn't have any friends through his conversation with someone else. Right? These are not things that he tells us. Does he ever reveal to the reader on his own any information about himself?
He doesn't believe in religion. He didn't mm-hmm. care for the cathedrals because he
yeah.
didn't feel the need for.
But again, that's something he reveals to Robert in conversation, right? And this, for somebody who spends as much time talking simply to the reader as this guy does, right? He spends no time on himself. So we know he's not religious. We know that he really, really wants his wife to like him more than she does. We know that he drinks and smokes weed. We know that he hates his job, but, you know, doesn't feel that there's any other options, right? But we don't really know anything about his, you know, about what's brought him to this point. We don't know anything about this guy's background. Did you have a hand up a second ago, Emily, or? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Imagine.
Yeah. It's funny, he tells us about how he feels about things, right? And he tells us information about other characters. But the only information we get about him is from other characters. And he never tells those other characters how he feels about anything. So he shares with the reader things he doesn't share with the other characters. And he shares with the other characters things that he doesn't seem to want to share with the reader. So we have definitely like a guarded kind of personality, right? Now, to get back to this whole thing about Robert not looking right for a blind man, what does this tell us about where the narrator gets most of his information about blind people, about anything? What sense does he rely most on?
TV
and movies, right? So he is relying on visual media to get a sense of what a blind person is supposed to look like. Is this the only way in which this guy seems to be hung up on the sense of sight? If we look at page 37, right, we talk about, you know, the blind man and his relationship with his wife. She died in a Seattle hospital room, the blind man sitting beside the bed and holding on to her hand. They'd married, lived and worked together, slept together, had sex, sure, and then the blind man had to bury her. All this without his ever having seen what the goddamn woman looked like. It was beyond my understanding. Hearing this, I felt sorry for the blind man a little bit. And then I found myself thinking what a pitiful life this woman must have led. Imagine a woman who could never see herself as she was seen in the eyes of her loved one. A woman who could go on day after day and never receive the smallest compliment from her beloved. A woman whose husband could never read the expression on her face, be it misery or something better. Someone who could wear makeup or not, what difference to him? She could, if she wanted, wear green eyeshadow on one eye, a straight pin in her nostril, yellow slacks and purple shoes, no matter. And then to slip on into death, the blind man's hand on her hand, his blind eye streaming tears, I'm imagining now. Her last thought may be this, that he never even knew what she looked like, and she on an express to the grave. Robert was left with a small insurance policy and half a 20 peso Mexican coin. The other half of the coin went into the box with her. Pathetic. So on the one hand, this does reveal an emotional depth in the narrator that, you know, maybe it didn't look like he had before. Especially sort of when he's making these kind of casually racist and casually sexist remarks prior to this. But what is the thing that bothers him about the blind man's marriage?
That they, they couldn't have a visual relationship, I guess. Like, nothing.
Yeah. Yeah, he's like, how could you love someone, how could you marry someone if you didn't know what they looked like?
It didn't make sense to him.
Yeah. It doesn't make sense to him that they can have a relationship that's not necessarily based on a visual impression, right? And it bothers him for her that her husband couldn't see what she looked like. Now, one thing that this does show us as well there is that the narrator has a very narrow sense of how you can tell what someone looks like, right? He has a very, very narrow sense of how you can actually get a feel for another person. What do we notice about the way Robert navigates the world once he shows up at the house? Is this somebody who can't see anything?
He seemed to have like adapted to it better than he expected him to.
Yeah, I mean, he adapts easily to a new environment. Robert has friends all over the world, right? You know, this is a guy, you know, we're talking about the late 70s here when facilities for the disabled were not what they are now. This is a guy who managed to get himself, you know, to the airport on a plane from Seattle to Connecticut and then take a train 5 hours to suburban New York all on his own, right? So this is clearly not someone who is helpless because he has no visual apparatus. And what other sorts of things can he just sort of, can he sense without having to use his, without a sense of sight? I mean, you know, what about the TV? He knows the difference between a black and white and a color TV, right? He doesn't know how he knows it, but he can still tell. So the fact that Robert has no visual sense doesn't mean that he has no vision, right? It doesn't mean that he can't see what's around him. Right? We see him relying on other senses. We see him relying on his hearing, relying on his sense of touch in particular. And that he has, you know, a relatively refined sense of taste as well. You know, he knows how he likes his scotch. Now, what else do we see about Robert's personality that's different? From the narrator's personality.
Like, he can see better than the narrator. He can see how everything, the narrator's wife is going when the narrator responds to it than the narrator
is. Yeah, he's more quickly responsive to other people's needs. What about the size of his world compared to the narrator's world, right? Do you guys know what a ham radio is? Okay, most of you, it's like a home radio set. I mean, you don't use it to listen to, you know, music or news, or like you use it just to contact other ham radio operators in other parts of the world, right? You send a very powerful signal and it comes back through a speaker. So through this ham radio setup he's got, right, he's got friends in Alaska, he's got friends in Tahiti, the Philippines, right, all over the place. The narrator has no friends at all, even in his own home area. What about when they share the joint? Has Robert ever smoked before? No. But he's open to the experience, right? He's like, yeah, sure, what the hell? I've never done it before. I'll try it. Right, so Robert is open-minded. He's open to new experiences. He's open to trying new things. The narrator is a creature very much of habit, right? What is this guy's life like? What are his usual evenings like?
Sleep, smokes, and watches TV till he can't stay up easy.
Yeah. Right, every night he basically drinks himself stupid, sits in front of the TV, and falls asleep smoking a joint. Same thing every day.
They seem a lot like binary, it's kind of opposite.
Yeah, exactly. Robert and the narrator do represent kind of opposite poles of human personality and human experience, right? That's a really good observation. So, what does getting to know Robert do for the narrator? How is it that the blind man, for him, becomes Robert? How is it that he's able to turn this abstraction, this idea of a blind person, into a real individualized human being? And this is actually just a quick side note, right? One of the weird things about this story, who were the only two people who were given names?
The wife and the blind man.
Yeah, Robert and his wife, right? Robert and Beulah. Now, Beulah, right, we never meet. She's already dead at the beginning of the story. But yeah, the only individualized character, right, with a name is Robert. So let's just sort of sit on that thought for a minute and go back to the point at which the narrator starts calling the blind man Robert.
I felt like it was after they smoked, it was almost like a climax or a turning point.
Uh-huh.
They really started opening up to it, and they started conversating a lot more.
The blind man asked him, so I feel like you might have been left out, or we haven't spoken to you.
Yeah.
Well, he's kind of just talked to him.
He shows he's been paying attention, right? And he also shows, you know, when he takes the joint from the narrator, he shows that he is willing to enter the narrator's world and is not going to force the narrator to enter his, right? I'll come to you on your terms. And this is how we'll connect, this is how we'll make friends. If we look at just these last couple pages about the cathedral itself, right? So we're running a little short on time. Right, page 43. We didn't say anything for a time. He was leaning forward with his head turned at me, his right ear aimed in the direction of the set. Very disconcerting. Now and then, his eyelids drooped and they snapped open again. Now and then, he put his fingers into his beard and tugged, like he was thinking about something he was hearing on the television. On the screen, a group of men wearing cowls was being set upon and tormented by men dressed in skeleton costumes and men dressed as devils. The men dressed as devils wore devil masks, horns, and long tails. The pageant was part of a procession. The Englishman who was narrating the thing said it took place in Spain once a year. I tried to explain to the blind man what was happening. Skeletons, he said. I know about skeletons, he said, and he nodded. The TV showed this one cathedral. Then there was a long, slow look at another one. Finally, the picture switched to the famous one in Paris with its flying buttresses and its spires reaching to the clouds. The camera pulled away to show the whole of the cathedral rising above the skyline. There were times when the Englishman who was telling the thing would shut up, would simply let the camera move around over the cathedrals, or else the camera would tour the countryside, men in fields walking behind oxen. I waited as long as I could. Then I felt I had to say something. I said, They're showing the outside of this cathedral now. Gargoyles. Little statues carved to look like monsters. Now I guess they're in Italy. Yeah, they're in Italy. There's paintings on the walls of this one church. Are those fresco paintings, bub? He asked. And he sipped from his drink. I reached for my glass. But it was empty. I tried to remember what I could remember. You're asking me, are those frescoes? I said. That's a good question. I don't know. Why does he feel pressured to speak?
Because he can't see what they're watching.
Yeah, he assumes that because Robert can't see what's going on the television, that he needs an explanation, right? That's part of it. What else does it tell us about this guy's personality? Can he just sit there quietly with another person in the room? He's got to say something, right? He's uncomfortable with silence, right? And we all know people like this, right? You're, you know, sitting someplace, you're reading or working on something, and, you know, this individual, hi, what you doing? Oh, you working on something? Hey, can I look at that? What is that? Oh, that's cool. Do you need any help? And your silence is interpreted, rightly or wrongly, as hostility. And then said person you hope goes away. But yeah, the narrator doesn't seem to be able to sit comfortably in silence with Robert, right? He's got to make conversation. He's got to do something. A sort of fidgety tick. The camera moved to a cathedral outside Lisbon. The differences in the Portuguese cathedral compared to the French and Italian were not that great. But they were there. Mostly the interior stuff. Then something occurred to me and I said, something has occurred to me. Do you have any idea what a cathedral is? What they look like, that is? Do you follow me? If somebody says cathedral to you, do you have any notion what they're talking about? Do you know the difference between that and a Baptist church, say? He let the smoke dribble from his mouth. I know they took hundreds of workers 50 or 100 years to build, he said. I just heard the man say that, of course. I know that generations of the same families worked in a cathedral. I heard him say that, too. The men who began their life's work on them, they never lived to see the completion of their work. In that wise, bub, they're no different from the rest of us, right? So, the things that Robert has picked up from the documentary on cathedrals focus on what feature of the cathedral, what aspect of the cathedral?
The non-visual.
Yeah, the non-visual, right? The work that goes into putting one together and the number of anonymous workmen who have to band together to get this thing built over long periods of time, knowing that they won't get any personal glory from doing this, right? This is something that large groups of people get together to do for the sake of the community. And I think that this is sort of where we're running out of time here, so we'll sort of end this here, right? That this is part of the idea of sitting together with their eyes closed, drawing the cathedral, right? Multiple people working on the same project together for the sake of forging community, right? For the sake of making a connection. Okay, so we'll end with that. We're going to be doing chapter one from Writing Analytically on Tuesday. So, you know, as I said, if you don't have the textbooks yet, try to get that one first because that's the one with the actual homework assignments in it. I do want you to do assignment three on page 37 and bring it to class with you. You'll then upload it to, you know, GeorgiaView. There's a Dropbox folder for it. Yeah, so work on that over the weekend and we'll see you on Tuesday.
And I upload it before we bring it?
Pardon?
Upload it after we bring it to class? Or before we...
You know what? Go ahead and upload it after you bring it to class in case, you know, what we talk about in class makes you want to fidget with it a little bit. Yeah. All right. Have a good weekend, everybody. We will see you on Tuesday.